It would be cool to give everyone a sense of like all the things that we actually do, the actual books that we produce, and to give you kind of a sample of the readings and the works that come out from all over the world. So before we get started on this really rapid fire, one after another sort of reading event, I thought I'd just have to thank, first of all, the College of Arts and Sciences for helping make all of this possible, the New York State Council on the Arts for their support, the National Endowment for the Arts for their support, and everyone, all of you, for coming. And turn down the volume. Anyways, okay. So when I came to the University of Rochester about 3.5 years ago, the very first person I met was Joanna Olmsted, the dean, who's going to be our first reader tonight. And she's going to actually read from Dubravka Jugresha's Nobody's Home. And the reason that it's interesting for her to read from that is that Dubravka's book was really the first book that we published. We knew when we set up the press that that was going to be the very first book. And there's an interesting story to it, is that I had published Dubravka's book, Thank You for Not Reading, back at a press that I used to work at before coming here. And E.J. Van Lannen, our senior editor, which will remain unnamed, period. And E.J. Van Lannen, our senior editor, when he was at Echo, he published another of Dubravka's books. So it was sort of a perfect kind of grouping that she wanted her book to be the very first open letter book, with her past two editors being the ones who worked on it and launching the whole series. Wow. So with that minor introduction, Joanna, you first one to read.
And I am delighted to be here, and I found it interesting that Chad or EJ or somebody had picked something having to do with biology that starts out with biology, since that's what I really do. this is called The Heart. There is a particular kind of canine parasite in North America, the heartworm. It invades the heart of a dog and then multiplies until the heart finally explodes like a hand grenade. In the waiting room of a veterinary clinic, I saw a model of an afflicted heart in a display case. It looked like a stuffed tomato with angel hair pasta sticking out every which way. Just to get your dinner. At this juncture, it isn't just dogs' hearts that are at risk. There may be something essentially wrong with the heart of the whole world. If doctors were to listen to that gigantic organ, who knows what they would find? It seems to me that the heart of the world is enlarged, tired. Its pulse is a touch arrhythmic, but I am no doctor. It is up to the experts to have their say. We are living at the start of the third millennium, and if someone were to ask what the global icon of the moment is, I would say without hesitation, the heart. The cultural obsession of our times with the heart prods me to caution. It must be that something is wrong with the heart of the world. The heart today has a growing number of promoters, ardent supporters, eloquent priests, and devoted subjects. The heart has affiliated itself recently with three princesses. First, there was Princess Diana, who promoted the ordinary human heart as her royal emblem and stirred an unprecedented flood of ordinary human tears. Then there was Oprah, the good fairy with a global television audience, who used the heart as her emblem. Instead of the colloquial break a leg, Oprah would finish her closing segment with the admonishment, break a heart. At one point in her career, Madonna chose the heart as her new media aura. In the video Frozen, a variant of Anderson's Snow Queen, Madonna speaks openly of thawing someone's frozen heart. You're frozen when your heart's not open. Which might, why not, be the global heart. Other promoters of the philosophy of the heart attach themselves to superstars like Diana, Oprah, and the Madonna. Paulo Coelho, a Brazilian writer with almost 100 million followers, is himself a media guru of the heart. In his books and interviews, Coelho openly pushes for the logic of the heart instead of the reasoning of the mind. And it is worth mentioning that Oprah and Coelho, experts on the human heart, readily make use of the terminology and symbols of angels. Oprah founded the Angel Network to aid poor children with talent. The unceasing search in Coelho's books is for angels, the embodiment of spirituality. The ideology of sincerity has attached itself to the current super metaphor of the heart. The brain does not require sincerity the way the heart does. The brain does not, we live in an age obsessed with sincerity. Both publishing memoirs and the television industry, TV confessionals from Oprah to Springer, live off of sincerity. This is how sincerity has become an essential value of our time and has it is headed towards becoming a moral, an aesthetic, even a social norm. It seems that I too am having heart trouble. The doctors say I have a tired heart, nothing terrible. The heart functions, they say, it is just a touch enlarged, sluggish. Obviously it has lost its youthful elasticity. I have noticed that I cry much more readily these days. Even the stupidest films, in which justice prevails in the end, reduce me to tears. I watch only old movies, because only in the old movies does justice prevail. This, it seems, is the source of the problem, a reversal of concepts. Without even realizing that the notion of old-fashioned justice has vanished from the stage of mass culture and from everyday life, yet aware that something key is missing, people have replaced the more exacting and complex concept of justice with the easier, softer, and more elastic concept of the heart. An exchange of vessels, an imperceptible, sneaky transaction with concepts, has given birth to a worldwide fraternity of angels, a global soap opera that has its producers, players, and consumers. And in the process, it is no longer clear, and meanwhile, it has stopped mattering. What is real life and what is a simulation? All in all, tears are shed, the world is awash in soap suds, and it is perfect, of course, as it has always been.
Thanks, Jen. One of the fun, very fun things about running Open Letter is working with all the interns that we have, such as Laurel Stewart, who's going to read next in a minute, and she can attest to the fact that we have a week long, or an hour long class every Friday, and 90% of that tends to be telling stories about things that happen in publishing and weird things about publishing. And one of them, Paulo Coelho, who surfaced in that last little piece for a second, when I was at the Frankfurt Book Fair a few years ago, Dan Brown, the author of The Da Vinci Code, who I'm sure you all know, had challenged Coelho, saying that he had more readers than Coelho did. So they actually brought out, they had a huge party, and they had the Guinness Book of World Records there to testify that Paulo Coelho had more worldwide readers than Dan Brown did. And as part of this, they had this crazy, it was so insane. There's a video that was running like above the bar. And what it was people who were fans of Paulo Coelho could send in a picture of themselves holding up their favorite book of his. And so it went on. I was there for like 2.5 hours, and there was never a loop. Like, it was just constant, like 2 seconds of someone else holding up a book. And all the publishers for Paulo Coelho got to drive home in Mercedes-Benzes. It was a very like decadent party. But another crazy story. to make a weird segue. As most people know, that are friends of mine, know that my favorite writer of all time is Thomas Pynchon. And one of the cool things, when we were publishing this book, The Taker and Other Stories, my friend David Kippen, who worked at the NEA, contacted me and said, oh, you know that Pynchon's a huge fan of Fonseca. I was like, how do you know that? He said, well, I found this blurb online that's in Portuguese for Fonseca. So we looked through it, and I searched everywhere to try and find the English version of this quote. It does not exist, right? So what we decided to do, in typical publishing fashion, since Pynchon's not exactly the most accessible of authors to ask about this, is decided to just translate it ourselves. So with the help of a Brazilian friend, Google Translate, and a little creativity, we came up with a blurb that's literally the front cover of our book now. It says, each of Fonseca's books is not only a worthwhile journey, it is also in some way a necessary one. And I can testify that the punctuation on this no way matches what Thomas Pynchon had in his original quote. And, you know, we kind of thought if he ever complained, that would be good publicity for us. So anyways, turn over to Laurel to read from Fonseca's book.